Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for this nice introduction. It's a pleasure to be part of this great event this afternoon. And I'd like to start by thanking Sophie and Diahala for making all this possible, for bringing me on board. I'm really happy to be here. I'm going to talk to you about machine intelligence for self-driving cars. And let me go back to where things started for myself. About 12 years ago, when I became a professor in Germany, we started working with Daimler Research. You can see they put their logo in the video. And we recorded videos out of a car, videos like this one, where you see what is the aim. The aim is to make driving safer, to avoid accidents, to see obstacles, to prevent accidents from happening. And this could be driver assistance. At the time, we mostly talked about driver assistance. Where the aim is to inform the driver, to send a warning signal as soon as something dangerous happens, but actively engage maybe in braking or steering the car, all the way to self-driving cars. 12 years ago, no one talked about this. I don't know if you remember, but in the media, you never read anything about it, neither about computer vision nor about artificial intelligence. But the fact that you're all here is one indication that things have drastically changed. And nowadays, I open the newspaper, and on the front page is self-driving cars, driver assistance, computer vision, artificial intelligence. It's all over the place. And one of the goals that we have is I want to show you a little bit some of the technologies we've developed over the last 15 years in this area. This is one of them. I don't know if the video is running, let me see. It's a technology that allows you to recover the 3D structure in front of the car. And you see this is 10 years ago, 2007, 2008 is when we developed this. And you can determine also the motion of things in 3D. Here color-coded, red means the structure is moving, green means it's static. And this motion is vital because it tells you not so much only what is there now, but also what's going to happen in the next few seconds. And this is important. You want to be able to predict the future here, to predict what will happen and to make a statement that this obstacle is not in the corridor, in the driving corridor now, but in the next 2 seconds, it will be. And that will be vital. Any second earlier you can make a prediction, the more lives you can save ultimately. And, you know, when we started, I said it wasn't a big thing in the media, but even in companies, it wasn't big. It was a single camera we had in the car back then in 2005. And when I said, can you put the second one? You know what they answered at Daimler? No, it's not possible. And I said, why not a second camera? They said, it's too expensive. Imagine that, right? Here you have a car, 50,000 euro, roughly. And the camera is, what, 10 euro? How can that be too expensive? It was too expensive for the top managers in the deciding positions. Why? Because they did not see a value in sensors. They didn't see a value in the first camera in the first place, and even less in the second camera. That's all changed. And I'm sure if you went back to these managers, they would no longer admit that today. In fact, around 2007 or 2006, they came and said, we need a second camera. Not really because I had been insisting for months and months. No, no. Because Toyota came out with two cameras, and so immediately, of course, we had to get a second camera. So, but this is, as I said, 10 years ago. I want to show you where we are now. I'm going to skip this slide. This is about myself. I built up in the last 7 years now. I moved to TU Munich, the top university in Germany, built up one of the largest computer vision teams in academia in the world. We have about 30 full-time employees, 25 PhD students, 5 postdocs, working obviously on quite a range of topics, and one of them is 3D reconstruction. Reconstruction from cameras. So what you see here is 3D reconstructions that we computed from 16 synchronized cameras that film an action like this rope jumping girl. And what you can see just from the images, we don't use laser, we just use cameras. Just from the images alone, we can recover the entire rope of a rope jumping girl at that level of detail. This is where we are today with camera-based techniques. And this is why much of the robotics community is moving from lasers and LiDARs to cameras. And I think this will also be true for self-driving cars. You know, we're all waiting for the self-driving car. I cannot tell you when exactly it's going to hit the market big time, but I can tell you the main sensor it will have is cameras. That's for sure. Why is that? Because nowadays we can take a single camera. You see on the top left here, the video of the camera. We can walk around in very nasty real-world conditions with very bad visibility, reflections, moving objects. And what you see on the right is an algorithm that we developed that can track such a camera in real time at a super high level of precision. I can walk around this entire subway station, go under it, come back out the other way, and the algorithm keeps track of the camera. At just one camera, no other sensor, a single camera. And of course it makes an error. From frame to frame, you track the motion of the camera. It's gonna make an error every frame, and there's thousands of frames. That error is gonna accumulate over time. This is called drift. What is the drift? You see it here. It's about 2 meters. The same bicycle on the top left is reconstructed twice. That's the error I accumulated, about 2 meters, on a distance of, I would say, 500 meters. So the precision, this tells you, is roughly 1%. And we can fuse that information with other sensors in a car. We actually went further and wanted to evaluate how precise is our method really. And we wanted to demonstrate to the world that this is indeed the world's most accurate real-time capable camera tracker. So we recorded hundreds of minutes of video, indoor, outdoor, everywhere, in very diverse environments. And then we quantified the error. And we demonstrated, we compared to what was considered the state of the art in this field, a method called OrbSlam, here printed in blue. And what you see here is lots of plots that measure the accuracy. Basically, what we show is on the right-hand side, what is the error? And on the maximum error in tracking, and on the top you see a top axis, on the y-axis you see how many runs can we track with that precision. And then you can compare and you can see if you say I want to track at least what are the best 300 sequences that I can track, the error for OrbSlam is 6, ours is 1. So we get an improvement of a factor of 6 with our method. Similarly, you can say if you want the maximum error to be 2, how many sequences can I really track with that error? OrbSlam can track 100, we can track 400 sequences with that error. So it's an increasement in robustness of a factor of 4. And then we can go as far as even, you know, as even computing shortest paths to do obstacle avoidance, trajectory optimization, path planning. And here you see an optimal trajectory that the algorithm computed in order to fly through a doorway. And it flew through it autonomously. No human pilot told it to do so. So these are experiments that we do with autonomous systems. This is not a car, no, it's a drone. The main difference is a drone has 3 degrees of freedom. A car has only 2. So some things are much simpler in cars, and we hope that with exactly these technologies, we will also be able to tackle the self-driving car challenge. And here are some first preliminary results. This is the same technologies I showed you, reconstructing the world in front of the car in real time, just from a stereo camera system. And what you can see is we can map the whole world in front of the car in 3D at a very high degree of precision and accuracy. At a level where if I drive around the block and come back, things line up, things match. And so with these technologies, you can compute in real time your exact location in the world and the 3D world in front of you. The obstacles, everything that you want to avoid and see. And again, I cannot tell you when exactly the self-driving cars will hit the market. But I can tell you for sure, one of the core components they will have are these 3D mapping algorithms. Because you need to know where am I at any given time in real time, and where is the 3D world. At a very high level precision and in real time, and that's exactly what this algorithm does. And so based on that, we said, let's bring these technologies to the market. And so we created a startup called Artisense. I'm one of the co-founders and chief scientific officer. And this is one of the prototypes we've developed. This prototype actually creates exactly the maps that I've shown you. And we're planning to deploy it in cars into the market and basically collaborate with a lot of the bigger car companies to bring it into the market, to acquire data of 3D data of the world. If you had one such system in every car today, you could instantly map all of Germany in a cloud. And this is one of the plans of what we plan to do. And we're looking predominantly right now for technical talents. We have quite some. We are looking for more. And we're looking for investors. So if you're interested in joining this or investing, please get in touch with me. Thank you for your attention.